to The Waymakers with your host, Minister Angela Gracie. I have a great show in store for you today, so get your cup of coffee, sit back, and relax. Father, for this day, this is the day that you have made, and we rejoice and we are glad in it. Father God, we honor you today. We come into your presence with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. We come boldly to your throne of grace today to obtain mercy and help in our time of need. Oh, Father, hallowed be your name. Father, today our hearts are heavy with all that is going on in our communities and with our young people. Father, we are a nation in chaos. And Father, today we just come into your presence asking for your grace, for your mercy, for your divine intervention, that your righteous judgment would prevail in the city of Baltimore today. We ask, Lord God, for our civic leaders, Lord God. Father, I ask for your spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of who you are to prevail in this situation. Father, we speak peace to the unrest there today in Jesus' name. Father, I come against the spirit of strife, the spirit of division, the spirit of rebellion in the city of Baltimore today, in the name of Jesus. I come against it, Lord God, and I plead the blood of Jesus over that entire region in Jesus' name. Father, I speak life to that region today in Jesus' name. I speak rest. I speak reconciliation in the name of Jesus. Father, you know the wrongs that have been suffered by your people, and you hear their cry, their blood calls out to you from the streets, Lord God. Father, I ask for your righteous judgment to prevail on behalf of your people in Jesus' name. Father, cause them to recognize you as their defense, as their advocate. Show yourself strong on behalf of those who are oppressed. Father, you said you hear the cry of all that are oppressed, and that you will exact righteousness for those who are oppressed. And so, Father, I thank you for exacting righteousness on their behalf today in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you for being the father to the fatherless. I thank you for being the righteous judge on their behalf today in Jesus' name. Father, I commit that whole region into your hands, Lord God. Father, I thank you, Lord God, that your warring and ministering angels are covering that region even now, in Jesus' name, bringing order, bringing rest right now in the matchless name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you for what you are doing on behalf of your people. Thank you for exacting righteousness for all who are oppressed today. In Jesus' name, we pray for every civic leader. We pray for our law enforcement leaders there. We pray for the faith-based leadership there. Father, thank you for granting them wisdom. Thank you for granting them creativity. Father, thank you for causing their voices to be heard in Jesus' name. Surround them, those who don't know you, surround them with men and women who walk after the counsel of your will, Lord God, that you would give divine direction according to your will and purpose. In the mighty name of Jesus, Father, we commit them into your hands today. And thank you, Father, for what you're doing on their behalf. And so, Father, today we welcome you to our time. We welcome you to this conversation. Who is under the sound of my voice, that you would even now begin to prepare their hearts, open the eyes of their understanding, cause them to recognize, Lord God, who they are and whose they are. Thank you for speaking a word in season to the weary through this broadcast today. Thank you for giving direction, for giving clarity for those whom you have called for this end time season. Thank you for strengthening them for the days ahead. Thank you, Father, that you are in the midst of us. Thank you that where two or more of us are gathered, in your name, that you are in the midst of us. And we know that if you are in the midst of us, we know that you hear us. And we know that if you hear us, that you will grant the petitions of our hearts. So, Father, today we purpose to trust in you and to lean not on our own understanding, but to trust you with all of our hearts and in all of our ways. We will acknowledge you so that you might direct our path, as these are critical days and critical times, but you will direct our path. You will guide us with your eye. You will show us the way in which we should go. And so we commit our way to you, Lord. We commit our plans to you. Cause them to be established and to succeed. Thank you, Father, that we can cast all of our cares upon you because you care for us and you know the way that we take. So give us rest in you, Lord. We come unto you, all of us who are weary and are heavy laden, because you promised that you would give us rest for our souls. Grant rest to the souls of those in Baltimore, Father. Grant rest to the souls that are oppressed. Grant rest to their souls today. This is our prayer, God. And we thank you, Lord, because we know that your word never returns void. It prospers in the lives whereunto we have spoken it. And so we trust you to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could ask or think. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray this prayer with thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, hello, and we're back. This is your host, Minister Angela Gracie, and you are listening to The Waymakers Live. Welcome to our broadcast today. I have so much to tell you about in the way of announcements, and so grab a cup of coffee, get a pen and a piece of paper so that you can take notes and stay abreast of all that we are doing in this season. We are indeed living in perilous times. Ladies and gentlemen, there's much for us to do. There is much in our nation and in our country that needs to be addressed. And God is calling upon the voice of one to cry out to a lost and dying world, to speak with one voice to the issues of the day. And I pray that you are praying with me in this season. This is the season leading up to Pentecost Sunday, and we have committed ourselves to fasting and prayer in whichever way that God leads you. But we are committing ourselves to fasting and prayer so that we can be empowered, be refilled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, so that we will be strengthened and empowered for the days ahead, to do what God has called us to do. So these are important times. And so I pray that you are praying with me. Of course, You know, we're praying for the city of Baltimore and all that is going on there. We are praying for the city of Nepal and for those who suffered terribly, the lives that were lost due to that disastrous earthquake. We want to continue to lift them in prayer and look for opportunities, look for ways to support and to help. You know, often many of us can't go, but we can send and we can support those who are going. And we can always, always, always keep them lifted in prayer. Prayer changes things. The effectual and fervent prayer of the righteous always avails much. So we want to keep those matters before the Lord and on the throne of grace. Amen? So let me tell you all about what happened. The last time we talked, it was the day before the MS walk, and we had a fabulous, fabulous time. If you haven't been checking us out on Facebook and on Twitter, you are missing out on all the happenings. So I just want to let you know, many of you, if you've been on our page, you know that we not only met our goal of $250 for our team, but we exceeded our goal. And we have given $350. Our team has raised, our ministry has raised, and I'm still looking for donations to come. I just found out from my friend Sharon that we have till July 1st to make donations. I thought we only had up until the day of the walk, but I understand now that we have even more time. So if you haven't had a chance to support us in this effort and you would like to give, please go to our website, www.angelicgraceministries.org. Click on the Walk MS box and give your donation. You will be helping to change the lives of many who struggle with the disease of MS. We had over 40 members on our team, on the Rose of Sharon team, and we intend to raise even more money and to have even more of our supporters come out and walk with us. We all had on T-shirts alike. I want to encourage you to go to our Facebook page at facebook.com/Angelic Grace Ministries. You'll see the photos there of some of the members of our team. Also, if you go to our Facebook page for the radio show, The Waymakers Live, you will also see some photos there. And on our blog, thewaymakers.blogspot.com, and you can also access it from our website as well. So check it out. We had a wonderful time. We were all dressed together, and it was an excellent, excellent endeavor. God blessed us with beautiful weather. I mean, the sun shone. It was a beautiful, warm day. It was just everything excellent about that event. So I want to encourage you, if you didn't get a chance to participate this year, put it on your calendar. We're going to do it every year in the month of April. It's usually around the second or third week in April, and we're going to be leaving right from Bowie Town Center. So wonderful, wonderful time was had. Also, that same day, I had a book signing and met some people, some wonderful women of God at Barnes & Noble. We were all there together supporting one another and signing our books, and we really, really had a great time. I want to give a warm shout-out to those who came by and supported and lent their support and their encouragement. I also want to give a warm thank you to Dr. Marva Butler, who served as the paparazzi for the day. She took pictures for us, and we just really had a grand time. And so if you missed it, I'm so sorry you missed it, but there will be other events, and I will be keeping you abreast of those as we move forward. Now, the latest thing, our newest thing is our book club. You know, we took 2 weeks off because we did the MS walk, but our book club met again. We resumed on April 25th. And we started with part two of the book. All during the month of May, we focused on part one of the book. But the book has two parts, and we started part two this past Saturday, and we will be finishing that up this coming Saturday on May 2nd. And so I want to invite many of you who would like to come. We had a wonderful media day in the month of April. Many of you have seen the copies of the Laurel Leader. We actually made the front cover, which is just phenomenal. Our meetup is also on the calendar in the Laurel Leader. It will be there every week. The paper comes out every Thursday. Get your copy so you can get the dates and times when we'll be meeting. We are also on Meetup. So I want to encourage you to go to meetup.com/The Waymakers Book Club. This is where we will officially communicate all of our dates and times for the book club, where members can join, where we can have discussions, where you can ask questions. We will be hosting photos and all of the book club events. We have some special things planned for the summer. We're planning a social event in the month of July, and details will be forthcoming about that. But I want to encourage you to come out. Now, this coming Saturday, May 2nd, this will be our final meeting for the month of May. Then we will resume again on Saturday, June 6th at 10 a.m. at the New Panera Bread in the Laurel Mall. And we will be meeting biweekly from that point forward. So the two dates in June you want to put on your calendar are Saturday, June 6th and Saturday, June 20th. Those are the dates that we will meet. And we will be starting over at part one. We will have completed the first round of part one, part two. But in June 6th, we will be starting over with part one of the book. So if you haven't had a chance to join us this past time, you will be able to start with us from the very beginning on June the 6th. We will be starting part one again. And you may sign up for this book, for this meetup. I want to give us some structure so that I, for one thing, one of the reasons I'm doing this too is so that I can capture everyone's email addresses and I can keep in touch with everyone. I feel bad when someone says, oh, I didn't get the email or I didn't get something. It's because I don't have I needed a central place to capture all of that information so that you won't be left out. So please go to meetup.com/The Waymakers Book Club. And sign up today to join not only the book club, but just to join the community of Waymakers that God is raising up, okay? Amen and amen. Also, we will be out on May 9th at the Laurel Main Street Festival on Saturday, May 9th. I believe it's an all-day event. It starts around 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning. And we will be there, the Waymakers Book Club. We will be there. I will be partnering with Belinda Young, who is the owner of Chosen Books. She and I will be partnering together. I will be there selling some of my books. Belinda will be there. We want to introduce you to the best in Christian literature for your spiritual growth. So come out that day. There's going to be loads of food, loads of fun and fellowship, all kinds of activities, really an opportunity to meet and greet the Laurel community. This is an annual event that happens every year. We are delighted to be a part of it this year. And so I really want to encourage you to come out and join us for this wonderful event. And that way, we will get the fellowship with one another. We will have 2 weeks off, or the last 3 weeks off. The last weekend is usually Memorial Day weekend, so we will take that weekend off. Many people want to travel and be with their families, but then we will be right back on Saturday, June 6th at the book club. And it's just a wonderful time for us to come together in a more relaxed setting to discuss the things of God, to discuss, to be equipped and empowered, to understand what God is calling us to do and why. And we do it over coffee, over light breakfast, and for a couple of hours, and it's just a wonderful way to start your weekend. So I really want to invite you to come out and join us for that event. Okay, well, our next segment is entitled Answering the Call, and I want to just take a brief pause. Excuse me. I just want to take a brief pause for us to do that, and then we're going. This is our segment of the show where entitled Answering the Call, and this is our coaching segment. This is the segment where I like to offer some direction, some teaching, some coaching for those of you who are walking on this journey with me, who are praying with me, and who are seeking what God is saying to them in this season for their lives as well. And so I just want to encourage you So stay tuned for this segment. This is just going to be a brief time out, and then we will be right back. We're back for this segment entitled Answering the Call. But first, I'd like to just tell you that there are ways in which you can continue to be more automated in your ministry and in your business. Please visit MWHY Radio Network site and receive a free trial of Hootsuite. When you sign up today, you will receive a free 30-day trial of Hootsuite Pro. Hootsuite's unique social media dashboard allows organizations to manage multiple social networks, engage and identify their audience, and analyze their social media campaigns. So visit www.mwhyradio.com and sign up for your trial by clicking the Hootsuite logo. So we want to thank Hootsuite for being one of our sponsors, and we want to make that offer available to you. Well, we're ready for answering the call. I hope you have a pen and a piece of paper. And listen, I'm excited. I encouraged you guys on our last call, on our last show, to tune in to AD The Bible Continues. This is a 12-week series. It started on Sunday, April 5th at 9 p.m. on NBC, and we have been following along and just really sharing in the experience of what it was like when the apostles began to lay the foundation for the early church. And I just really want to highly encourage you to get on board. If you haven't had a chance to watch up until this point, you still have time. I think this is the third episode we've just seen, April 5th, 12th, 19th, maybe the fourth episode that we've seen. And they've really covered, biblically, they have covered all the way up to the book of Acts, chapter 6. So let me just kind of summarize the last episode. We saw the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost came in the upper room. The apostles were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke in other languages, and they were empowered now to be witnesses of Jesus. Remember, he said, you will receive power to be my witnesses after the Holy Ghost comes. And that's exactly what happened. And Peter makes his landmark address to the people, and he makes a powerful declaration that the kingdom of heaven is at hand and we shall enter in. And I didn't think they really did a great job of capturing the totality of Peter's address, but I can, as I said to you before, don't get all hung up on that. Just get your Bible out and read it for yourself. It was a phenomenal address, and what they really wanted to capture was the fact that Peter makes this powerful declaration that right after receiving the power of the Holy Spirit, they go from being scared men hovering and cowering in an upper room in a corner to being men who speak boldly for the cause of Christ. And I think that that is the most significant part of that last episode. Also, the church begins to form. They begin meeting together. The apostles are teaching daily in the synagogues and in the towns. The people are coming together. They have all things in common. They are sharing the word with one another. They're sharing breaking bread together and going from house to house. And they are really becoming a community of believers. And we see that begin to happen. And as they begin to come together, they bring all of their resources together. Everything that they have, they bring it together. Nobody is lacking anything. Nobody is without need. The scripture says that there was none destitute or needy among them, for as many as the ones who had lands and houses, they proceeded to sell them, and they brought everything that they had together. They brought whatever the amount, and they gave that amount that was received from the sales, and they laid it at the feet of the apostles, the special messengers, and the apostles distributed what they were given according to anyone who had need. So everyone was being taken care of. And then we had a special situation, right? And it goes on to say, we're not going to get to Gamaliel yet, but the next major thing that happens is Ananias and Sapphira. They also have property to sell. And they go and they sell their property, and they come and they bring proceeds from the sale of the property, but instead of them revealing what the total amount was for the sale, they lie. And they decide to tell them, they decide to hold back a portion of it and hide it and only report the balance as the total sale of their property. And that's what they bring to lay at the apostles' feet. And, of course, it is discovered later, God shows Peter in a vision that they were not telling the truth when they said that was the total amount of what their property was. And so they not only lied to the disciples, to the apostles, but they actually stand before God, and they lie really in the presence of God. And that act meets with a very tragic end because, of course, we read in the scriptures that Ananias drops dead right where he stood. And then his wife comes in sometime later, not realizing what has taken place, and she's asked the very same question, a very direct, pointed question. Did you bring the total amount that was sold, that was the proceeds from the sale of your house? And, of course, she tells the same story as her husband, and she meets with the same end. And the moral of the story here is, listen, we don't have to lie to God. He knows everything anyway. We may think that we're lying to one another, and we can hold back certain information from one another, but we can't hide anything from God. God sees exactly what we're doing. He knows the thoughts and intents of our heart. He knows what our motives are. And the truth of the matter was that Ananias and Sapphira had no reason to lie. They really didn't. They could have just told the truth. And so the fact that they were so blatant and they've come together, they have all things in common, and they come into a setting where they are honoring God with their gifts, and they come and bring their gift, and then they lie. And God did not take very kindly to that, and he dealt with them very strongly. And so let that be a lesson to all of us, that we must, absolutely must, come before the Father with clean hands and a pure heart. And then we read about Gamaliel. Now, by this time, the apostles, Peter and John, they have been jailed. They've been beaten and thrown in jail because they have been preaching the gospel. And the Sanhedrin and the Jewish leaders of the day, they're trying to decide what in the world are they going to do with these men. So at first they brought them in, and Gamaliel said, look, take them away. Just put them away somewhere for the moment out of our company. And he began to address the crowd. And this is what he says to them in chapter 5, verse 38. He says, now, in the current case that they're dealing with, meaning Peter and John, he says, let me say to you, stand off, withdraw from these men, and let them alone. For if this doctrine or purpose or undertaking or movement is of human origin, it will fail. It will be overthrown, and it will come to nothing. But if it is of God, you will not be able to stop or overthrow or destroy them. You might even be found fighting against God. So Gamaliel gives him a very strong message, and he says, look, you need to leave these guys alone. Because if what they're doing is of their in their something they're doing in their own flesh, it will come to naught anyway. But if it is of God, you are on shaky ground. You may be on thin ice because nothing you do will destroy them, and then you will be contending with God, which is a very dangerous place to be in. And so let that also just be a word for us. We will come up against opposition, but anything that we try to do in this season in our own strength will come to naught. But when we are on a kingdom assignment with a kingdom purpose, which these apostles were, nothing will be able to oppose or to destroy us. Amen? No weapon formed against us will prosper. God promises that he will take care of us. So Peter and John, this is how they react. So, Gamaliel was able to convince the leaders to leave them alone. So they went out from the presence of the council, the Sanhedrin. This is Peter and John. They flogged them, and then they warned them and forbade them to speak about Jesus again. And then the scripture says in verse 41, so they went out from among the presence of the council, the Sanhedrin, rejoicing that they were being counted worthy, dignified by the indignity to suffer shame and be exposed to disgrace for the sake of his name. Yet, in spite of the threats, they never ceased for a single day, both in the temple area or at home, to teach and to proclaim the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ as the Messiah. They never ceased to preach Jesus Christ. And that is very, very significant. They counted it a privilege to do that for Jesus Christ. Amen? I think that that is absolutely phenomenal. And they are to be commended for such an one. And so I want to, when we come back, we're going to take a brief break. And I want to come back and talk to you a little bit about suffering being the sign of your apostolic calling. Because our suffering in this season is just a momentary and a light affliction compared to the glory that will be revealed in us. And we're going to talk about that in the days ahead, about the revealing of the sons of God. But right now, I'm getting excited and I'm getting ahead of myself because I'm so excited to kind of share this part with you. And so we're going to take a brief break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about suffering, a sign of apostolic calling. So, let me just tell you what is really, really great, because MWHY Radio, we are on iHeartRadio now, and God has given us a major platform, and this is an opportunity to really, really get our message out. So I want to thank AMFM 247 for taking MWHY Radio Network to different AM and FM stations across the U.S. So today I want to thank everyone who is listening in Tampa, Florida, Las Vegas, Nevada, Macon, Georgia, Lancaster, Pennsylvania, Boulder, Colorado, Richmond, Virginia, and Greenville, North Carolina, and Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Thank you, thank you, thank you to all of those who listen to our programming and to our channel in those areas. I want to also thank all of the countries who continue to download our shows from iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn, Windows Xbox, Blog Talk Radio, and even Facebook, and many other podcasting sites. We promise to continue to bring you awesome talk and music programs every single day. Thank you so much for listening. We really appreciate your support and your commitment to MWHY Radio. And so I say that, we say that on behalf of our producers and on behalf of all of our hosts. Thank you so very much for listening. And so now we're going to take a commercial break, and when we come back, we're going to talk. We have our segment, Meditation of the Heart, and we will be talking about suffering, a sign of your apostolic calling. Amen?
Hi, this is Capri Smith of the Uncuffed Radio Show. Join me every Saturday at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time to learn how you can grow in your business, personal environment, and reach your true potential by uncuffing what is binding you, only on the Maybe Help You Radio Network.
I'm Tanya Free. What does it mean to be a teacher? Perhaps it's easier to define what a teacher is not. The 11 Atlanta teachers recently convicted of standardized test cheating. Investigators said the teachers held cheating parties where incorrect answers on student tests were erased, changed, and corrected. What were they thinking or not thinking? Then there are those that won't let go of the past. The sons of Confederate veterans in Texas are proposing a license plate with the rebel battle flag. After several votes, the DMV rejected the proposed plates. The sons of Confederate veterans sued over violation of free speech and won in federal appeals court. Texas has appealed to the Supreme Court. Stay tuned, the battle continues. Finally, does driving while black mean you can't drive a luxury car? Well, actor Isaiah Washington has some advice for Chris Rock, who has been pulled over 3 times in less than 2 months. Get rid of your luxury car like he did and buy 3 Priuses. Really, Isaiah? Let's talk about it. Join the conversation. These stories and more. Wednesday on a Tanya Free and Friends talk show and 24/7 on TanyaFree.com. Until then, be free and remember to live life with a purpose.
The Tanya Free and Friends Talk Show, your destination for the best in social and political straight talk. Wednesdays at 2 p.m., streaming live on TanyaFree.com and BlackTalkRadioNetwork.com. Join the conversation Wednesdays at 2 p.m.
Hey, Chef Jovi here of the Eat Experience Radio Show. Join me 10 a.m. every Thursday to explore recipes, best restaurants, and food spots in and around the country. I look forward to receiving your comments, so follow us on Spreaker.com to tune into the show. That's Spreaker.com. And search MWHY Radio to join me every Thursday, 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, for the Eatsperience Radio Show. And remember to share your Eatsperience.
If you're the parent of a child with behavioral challenges that has been suspended, expelled, or just not able to make it in a traditional school setting, there is an alternative. Call the Metropolitan Day School today. Licensed and accredited grades K through 12. Call 804-321-2595. Financial assistance and after-school programs are available. Let's turn this school year around right now at the Metropolitan Day School, where eagles soar. Call Ms. Thomas today, 804-321-2595.
Well, hello, and we're back. This is your host, Minister Angela Gracie. If you're just tuning in with us, you are listening to The Waymakers Live. And this is our segment entitled Meditation of the Heart. And our topic for our study this afternoon is entitled Suffering, a Sign of Your Apostolic Calling. And I'd like to read something in your hearing that I came across online. It's an excellent, excellent example of how suffering is part of our call as ambassadors for Christ and as a part of our apostolic calling on our assignment. And so I'd like to read this to you in your hearing, and then I want to share with you a personal testimony from myself as a part of my own experience that I really pray will, first of all, help you to understand where you are in the process and the role that suffering plays in your call in this end time hour, and also how God is grooming you. Now, in our previous segment, I read to you how Peter and John actually came away from being beaten and flogged, and they were rejoicing because they counted it a privilege to suffer for the cause of Christ. In fact, if you watch the segment of AD, the Bible, actually it shows them they're in prison. They had just got thrown in prison, and their faces all bloody and everything. And John look like they hit them in one eye so bad his eye closed. And they're sitting there, and after they're thrown in there in the dungeon, they just kind of look over at each other, and you don't know what you don't know what they're going to say, and they look over at each other, and you see this smile just break out on their face, like, yeah, this is good, like, yeah, so what, you know, this is what's supposed to happen, and you just see this smile, this knowing of like, hey, you know, this is cool, we must be doing something right, and so. I really like that little scene on there. And I'm telling you, you know, these are the little nuances that you pick up when you actually see this visually played out on the screen. But I want to read scripture in your hearing, and I want to read you some text that I hope will help bring understanding and enlightenment and clarity so that you understand the will of God concerning you in this season. So I'm reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 6. And it says, and if we are afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation, which results in your enduring of the same sufferings that we also suffer. And if we are comforted, it is for your consolation and salvation. And our hope of you is steadfast, knowing that as you are partakers of the suffering, so shall you also be partakers of the consolation. It is difficult to understand why suffering must come for the calling on your life when those around you are affected. So in other words, it's one thing for you to be affected, but it's another thing when those around you are being affected. That is something very much different. And so we want to be able to recognize that God has called suffering to be a part of our lives. And even though there may be others who suffer with us, still God has called us to be partakers of the suffering of Jesus Christ. And so we want to be able to know that God is taking care of us regardless. Sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. Just a little brief glitch in my technical system here, but I think I'm on track now. So we understand that suffering is a part of our calling, but it can be difficult when it affects those around us. I remember crying out to the Lord many times when Tony and I were struggling and I knew my husband was frustrated, with just the financial challenges that we faced as I stepped out in faith to answer the call of God and to pursue what I believed God had given me to do. And, you know, there were many sacrifices that were made, and oftentimes I felt bad because I felt like there was so much pressure on him. But I cried out to God about it, and my testimony is that God has never let me down. So I've aired my frustrations so many times to, you know, a friend of mine who is a trusted friend that I knew I could share these struggles with. And I remember sharing this with my former pastor one time, and she said, listen, I face the same thing, you know, at times because as a mother, you know, when you go through sacrifices, she's had to go through the same thing and watch her children go without sometimes and just having to tell them no when times were hard, a difficulty, and they could not always give them what they wanted or what blessing, and that can be very difficult. So this caused me to rethink my life and also realize that the suffering that the apostle is called to face as part of his or her preparation is both a privilege and a necessity for their mandate. So she helped me to understand that this was a part of the process, that when I looked back even over my own life to realize that, the things that I went through, they were necessary and or as part of my preparation for the apostolic call on my life. Paul said it so well in the above passage. He said, look, knowing that as you are partakers of the sufferings, so shall you be also of the consolation. Because of the suffering that Paul had to endure, those under him were consoled because he faced the sufferings for them. Just as Jesus went to the cross and faced death for us, so also will we be called upon time and time again to face sufferings and to overcome them for the sake of others. And that's a very key point to understand and to remember, that we are momentary yet light afflictions. They don't seem light to us at the time, but they are working a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. And they are not just for us. They are for those whom God gives to us. They are for those who are watching. They are for those whom we are called to teach and to mentor and to coach. It is for their benefit that we face and overcome the sufferings of this present day. The Lord has chosen us as his vessels to be effective, and we need to have the life-changing answers that will revolutionize the church, the new church, the redeemed church, the reconfigured church, the new creation. Amen? That kind of wisdom and those kinds of answers can only come to us in one way, and that is through sufferings. So if you have faced more hard times than the average believer, raise your hand if that's you. If you have faced more hard times than the average believer and you seem to experience one wave of difficulty after the next, then rejoice. Rejoice and be glad. Rejoice in the dignity of the indignity. For this is yet a sign that you are called to the apostolic ministry, and it is also the tool of the Lord to prepare you to be effective in ministry. Rejoice in the dignity of the indignity. Amen? There's dignity in the indignity. I like that. I like that. And so we hear that. And you, as you all know, the Waymakers, Ambassadors for Christ, Preparing the Way of the Lord, is my newest book. And I share my testimony of my preparation and my apostolic call. And I also went through a season of tremendous opposition, tremendous rejection, and tremendous suffering. And I learned along the way, one of the most important things that I learned is that it is all a part of the call. Amen? So I just want to read part of my testimony in your hearing, just a brief segment, and I'm hoping that this will bless you, that you will begin to understand what God is doing in your life and know that this is a part of the process. And you have to go through the process. This is called process, not like happens overnight, but process. And we must needs go through the process. Shortcuts avail nothing in the kingdom of God. In order to be an instrument that God can use, you must go through and endure the process of suffering. We all have a calling on our lives, and I'm reading from you from my book from page 38. This is in the chapter entitled The Making of a Waymaker, and I'm reading the section entitled Enduring the Cross. And I'm starting on page 38. We all have a calling on our lives. Our success in making it to the finish line largely depends upon our ability to endure. The word endure means to hold up under pain and fatigue, to tolerate, to continue, to last, to bear pain without flinching. There are many of us who recognize the call of God on our lives, but we're not willing to allow him to shape us into the man or woman we are destined to become from the foundation of the world. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 24, Jesus said unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Enduring the cross means to hold up under the suffering, pain, and hardship, and even death to self for the sake of Jesus Christ. Many of the early apostles, just as a side note, many of them are going to lose their lives. Many of them are going to die for the cause of Christ, and we're going to see it unfold on the screen. But many of us will not have to suffer that same fate for the cause of Christ. It will not become that grave. It can, but for most of us, it's going to mean a dying to our inner self, dying to our own agenda, dying to the desires of the flesh. Because remember, Jesus' yoke is easy and his burden is light. And so we won't have to suffer a horrible death by crucifixion on a wooden cross, but we will be called to die nonetheless. Paul says his desire is that he may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. And he talks about this in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. What is meant by fellowship of his sufferings? Well, the word fellowship is defined as a relationship in which parties hold something in common, a familiar interaction. We cannot know God, quote unquote, that is, be in fellowship with him, unless we, through Jesus Christ, hold the thoughts, feelings, and purposes of his heart. I have been touched, I, Angela, have been touched with the feelings of his infirmity. I have endured false accusations, being the subject of controversy, being judged, misunderstood, treated unfairly. I've been lied to, betrayed, and disrespected. I have experienced opposition that produced enormous pressure, discomfort, and stress. And yet, I have watched God defend my cause, vindicate me, and reposition me by his grace. And he will do the same for you. We, that is Jesus and I, we have fellowship with each other through suffering. But fellowship is not found just in the sharing of purposes, passions, and preferences. It is also the sharing of joys and sorrows, fellowship and conflict. What makes Jesus' resurrection so powerful is the suffering that preceded it. Before there is resurrection, before there is any glory at all, there is suffering, and we cannot have one without the other. So as I said earlier, I was met with so much opposition to the point that I felt like I was taking the greatest spiritual test of my inner life. God was calling me to deny myself, take up my cross, and follow him. That meant dying to my agenda, to being right, to being included, to my perceived rights, to my reputation, to my control, to the temptation to defend myself, and to refrain from quitting. The struggle was enormous, and in my distress, I cried out to the Lord, God, help me. And God spoke to me through his word, and he asked me, if I can endure all that I endured for you, can you not endure this for me? And he was speaking to me from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 2 and 3. Needless to say, I dissolved into a puddle of tears. My greatest desire was, and it still is, to please him and to be found trustworthy and faithful to stay the course that he set for me. I did not want to let him down. And I know that you don't either. In Hebrews chapter 4, verses 15 through 16, the writer goes on to say, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just like we have been, and yet he did not sin. So let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in time of need. That's what I did. I went to him and I asked him for his help. The question is, are we willing to empathize with his sufferings? Are we willing to run this race that he's marked out for us? What I've come to understand is that there are three things that are required to run our race with patience, and that is focus, patience, and endurance. And we're going to talk about each of those over the next coming weeks and over the next broadcast. And we're going to talk about what it takes to endure opposition, what it takes to endure and to be found worthy to be called an apostle, an ambassador of Jesus Christ. So, Father, I just come before you right now, thanking you for your word, thanking you for just counting us worthy to be called your disciples, to count us worthy to suffer the dignity, to the dignity of the indignity. Father, may we be found worthy of serving you. May we be found worthy that our walk is such that we take such a stand for Christ that we are worthy of being rejected. You, Jesus, you told us that because they rejected you, they will reject us. Let us be found worthy to walk worthy of the vocation to which we are called. Father, empower us by your Spirit, Lord God, to walk worthy of this vocation to which we are called, that we will make our calling and election sure. Father, I just thank you that you have called us to the kingdom for such a time as this, and that you are the one who equips and empowers. And over even in this next season, as we commit ourselves to prayer and to fasting, that you will empower us from on high by your Spirit, that we would be infused and endowed with your Spirit, that we would be strengthened and empowered to be witnesses unto you and to declare your message with one apostolic voice in this end time hour. Thank you, Father, for what you would do in us and through us in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, we don't want to close our broadcast today, ladies and gentlemen. We don't want to assume that there's anyone under the sound of my voice who knows the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And so I want to give you an opportunity right now that if you have a heart to serve God, you have a hunger and thirst, God is drawing you by his Spirit. You may not even realize it, but you are on this call. You are listening to this broadcast for one purpose and one purpose only, and that is so that you can become a member of the household of faith. It is so that you can decide, make a decision today to make Jesus your Lord and Savior and to make your Heavenly Father your new Father. Not the Father of this world, but your new Heavenly Father who cares for you and loves you so much that he sent his only begotten Son to die for your sins. And if you believe that he is the Son of the living God, that he died on a cross and was raised again on the third day, if you believe that in your heart, and if you can confess with your mouth that you are a sinner and that you want him to forgive you of your sins, you shall be saved. And so pray with me, Father. I recognize my need for a Savior, and I know that Jesus Christ died for the redemption, for the forgiveness of my sins. And so, Lord Jesus, forgive me. Come into my heart. Make me a new creature. Make me the man or woman that you have called me to be. Fill me with your Spirit. Endow me with purpose. Make me who you've called me to be. I make you my Lord and my Savior. If you just prayed that prayer with me today, I want you to know that all of the angels in heaven are rejoicing right now. And God is pleased. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. I want you to know that the Waymakers Live is happy to be sponsored by Audible.com, a leading provider of spoken digital audio entertainment. They have over 150,000 titles to choose from, and you can listen to them on any device, including whatever you are listening to us on right now. Now, if you sign up at our URL, which is audibletrial.com/MWHYLLC, you get one free audiobook and a one-month trial of the service. So if you are looking for books on inner healing, forgiveness, perhaps you're looking for books on leadership and ministry or the apostolic call, if you're looking for books on any of those topics, this trial is perfect for you. So we encourage our listeners of the Waymakers Live to go to audibletrial.com/MWHYLLC and order your copy today. Because here on the Waymakers Live, books rock. Amen. We'll be right back for a commercial break, and then we will be right back. God bless you in your walk with Jesus Christ.
The Queen Esther Radio Show is live every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Join me, Jessica Taylor.
And me, Jason Mosley, to be entertained by authors, artists, and spiritual leaders.
We look forward to being a blessing in your life every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Only on the MWHY Radio Network.
Hello, I'm Sherelle of Fit and Flow Yoga Radio. Wake up with me every Friday at 6 a.m. and have a wonderful yoga experience. We'll explore meditation and discuss how various yoga postures can help relieve your everyday stress. We'll also make the connection between our faith and wellness. Follow us on Spreaker.com to tune into the show. That's Spreaker, S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R.com. And also search MWHY Radio to join me every Friday at 6 a.m. for Fit and Flow Yoga Radio with Sherelle. And until next time, surrender to your strength and always embrace your flow.
Are you frustrated, disappointed, discouraged with your life? Are you angry with God? What's holding you back from fulfilling your purpose? Are you struggling as a leader in ministry? Do you believe you have an end-time calling? If you answered yes to any of these questions, tune in to The Waymakers on MWHY Radio Network every other Friday at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. We are here to support you. Join us to get the answers that will prepare the way of the Lord in your life.
Hi, my name is Letitia M., owner of May We Help You Network. I want to thank you for joining us and enjoying our host here on MWHY Radio Network. Please visit us online at MWHYradio.com and like us on Facebook.com/MWHYradio. Tune in to learn more about our host and upcoming contest and our TV programming that'll be coming to you soon. MWHY Radio, bringing together business, community, and you.
Well, that's our show for today. Thank you for tuning in to The Waymakers. It's been great hanging out with you today. Thank you for inviting us into your home. We are an outreach ministry of Angelic Grace Ministries International. To contact us and to order your copy of The Waymakers, visit us at www.angelicgraceministries.org. That's www.angelicgraceministries.org. Or connect with us on Facebook at facebook.com/angelicgraceministries. And follow us on Twitter at The Waymakers. This is your host, Minister Angela Gracie. And until we meet again, be a waymaker. Prepare the way of the Lord.